every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So today I want to talk to you about something that a lot of people struggle with. The idea of work that does not feel like it's part of the purpose. So many of us are in jobs that we just can't even imagine how they could be part of the purpose. Jobs that we don't like. We don't want to get up and go every day. It's really hard. Having a boss who's tough, having coworkers who don't do their part and it leaves more work for you. I mean, there are just a million different situations. There are as many difficult situations as there are people. So I thought it might make sense to talk about the whole aspect of work. Where does that play a role when we know that we know that we know that we're not in the job that is really our purpose in life? And we don't bounce up out of bed and can't wait to get there in the morning. And we can't figure out how in the world we can get from where we are right now with the work that we're doing over into just loving our life, loving every aspect of our life every single day. Well, I want to talk about that because your purpose may very well involve you being in a job that you don't love for a season. Maybe there's something you're supposed to do. Maybe there's someone you're supposed to meet. Maybe there's someone who is going to be your best friend for life. And the only way that you're going to meet that person is through this job. There are a million different scenarios as to why you're there. But if you find yourself in that kind of a situation, I want you to think about that work, whatever it is, whatever you're getting paid to do, you're exchanging time of your life that once it's gone, you can never get it back. You're exchanging that time for money from an employer. That exchange, that transaction, dignifies you. The fact that someone is willing to pay you to do a thing says you're valuable. You're needed in that place. That gives us dignity. So I know that, you might be saying, oh, but I hate this job, or it's a minimum wage job. It's just not that important. Or, well, you know what? Every legal, honorable, moral, let me add those qualifiers, job gives dignity. It's a mindset. And I hope you embrace it, because work helps us reverse self-criticism. It helps us reverse low self-esteem. Work builds our self-respect and our dignity if we see it that way. The example that I like to use is when President John F. Kennedy decided to visit NASA. And he came in and, there's the whole entourage, there's Secret Service, there's all this. And dignitaries had visited before. And so the protocol was established of how this would go. And they would walk President Kennedy through and give him this tour. And then he would meet with the leadership. But President Kennedy took a little detour. So he saw a janitor. And so he sort of veered off the tour. And when the president of the United States decides to stop, everybody stops, right? So he walked over to the janitor and he introduced himself. And everybody's just kind of watching this whole thing take place because none of the people at NASA had ever given one single thought to the idea that a dignitary would stop and speak to the janitor. Everybody else just followed the program. So when President Kennedy approached the janitor and introduced himself, which of course was unnecessary, his name was and still is and always will be, I guess, in the United States anyway, a household name. And this man stood up from his mop and President Kennedy said, "What do you do here, sir?" It was pretty obvious what he did, right? But the janitor stood up straight and he turned toward the president of the United States and he said, "Mr. President, I'm helping to send a man to the moon." And everyone who was standing there took this in. It was reported. I'm telling the story now, all these years later. The point is that this man didn't see himself as a lowly janitor that no one would ever want to talk to, that didn't do anything consequential in this organization. This man saw himself as part of something bigger, as doing something important, doing his part, but something important. So if you are in a job that you just can't stand, I want to encourage you. Learn what you can about the company. Learn what you can about the products. Learn what you can about the industry and try to see the bigger picture of what's going on there. Is it a product or a service that makes people's lives better? Is it something that serves people in some way? Is it a business that provides some kind of a product or service to other businesses? Good. Look at that business. Look at the whole supply chain. Try to get the bigger picture is what I'm trying to say, because what we know to be true is when we look at something in detail, microscopic detail, the smaller the detail, the smaller it looks, the smaller the perspective, the smaller the power around it. When we come up a little bit higher and we look at the bigger picture, and I always like to say, let's get to 30,000 feet, because, you know, if you're up in an airplane and you're looking down 30,000 feet, you can't see the cars. You can't see the people. You see the much bigger picture. Somewhere in between there, if you can get the bigger picture of what that company exists to do and what the end user does or what happens at the end of that supply chain, if you can see yourself fitting into that somehow, adding what you can add to that, it'll help you to hang on until you find that place where you know that you know that you know that you're supposed to be. When you have that kind of broader perspective, it can help reverse depression and sadness. Now, that might sound ridiculous to you, but I'm telling you it's true. And I know it because I've lived it. okay? I don't talk about stuff that I haven't experienced myself. I was in a job that just was, I didn't like it. It was hard for me because I wasn't using my skills and talents and abilities. It was like a round peg in a square hole or vice versa, whatever. It was not good. I was not good at this job. Despite that I tried really, really hard and I worked really hard and I tried to learn and I did all the things, but I just wasn't great at it. And so my self-esteem suffered and I wasn't the best person for the company. But I learned what I'm telling you now, that I was able to look at that situation as a season. I was there for a reason, and the reason was to allow character to be built in me, to learn everything I needed to know for the next chapter of my life, and to learn things about myself that I didn't know. I would have to add, in my case, it was also about acquiring patience, because I needed that job. I had no family. I had no safety net. I had no money. I had no savings. I was fairly freshly out of foster care. And so, if I wanted to eat, I need to keep going to the job. And so I was stuck. But as long as I saw myself as being stuck, I was miserable. But when I began to see myself as, okay, this is an opportunity. I'm going to learn everything I can learn. And I have to say, there were people who I worked with, some of the owners, some of the bosses, who were not helpful, let me put it that way, about trying to teach me or whatever else. I had to own the responsibility for learning as much as I could learn. That's what I mean when I say I think we should all mine the lessons out of the hard things that we go through, because it's on us. It's not anybody else's responsibility to teach us whatever it is we're there to learn. It's on us, because sometimes the things that we're supposed to learn are how to deal with difficult people, how to get along with people who don't care what happens to you, how to learn how to deal with different cultures and different personalities and all of those kinds of things. There's so much to learn. The more difficult the situation, the more you can learn. Because you probably already know this, we don't learn the really important lessons of life in the good times, in the fun times. We just don't. It's in the hard times of our lives that we learn the most significant, the most powerful lessons. Those lessons are stepping stones to the next level. So if we don't buckle down and learn what it is we're in that situation to learn, we might find ourselves staying there twice as long. And maybe in difficult situations, one after the next forever. Because I've noticed, at least for me, that God loves me enough to let me take the test over and over and over again until I finally get it. So when we adopt this mindset of finding purpose in every single aspect of our work and in our lives, for that matter, in every relationship, difficult neighbors, family, whatever it is, when we adopt this mindset of finding meaning, finding purpose, putting things into context and perspective, we really can enjoy every minute of our lives, even in the hard times. We can mine the lessons out of everything that we go through, and we can embrace everything in between. And this is how we can actually do what it says in Proverbs 31, to laugh without fear of the future. Think about that. The idea of laughing without fear of the future kind of makes my stomach twist a little bit, because I think about, okay, well, what are the things we fear? We fear getting in a car accident. We fear being betrayed. We fear our kids or grandkids making bad decisions. We fear, being broke. We fear losing our job. Whatever we fear, there's a million things. So how in the world can we laugh without fear of the future? Well, when we embrace the idea that we can find purpose in everything we do, we can accept that hard things are part of the process, and that difficult experiences are the teachers of the hard lessons. That allows us to live without fear. That allows us to look at circumstances and say, okay, I've gotten through all of my hard days. I'm going to get through every future hard day. This is the only way I know that we actually can live laughing without fear of the future, enjoying our lives. That's really evidence of living our purpose, when we really are enjoying our lives. Because let me just tell you, if you don't already know, there's absolutely no guarantee that everything at some point in time is going to be perfect. It just won't. As hard as you work, as much as you try, you can't make everything perfect, because we can't control the world. We can't control what's happening in our culture and our economy and, all these different things. The only thing that we really can control is we can control our thoughts, our attitudes, and our behaviors. We can't even do that for anybody else. It's just us. But when we do that, we set examples for all the people around us to do that. See, when we say, when we're living this lifestyle, embracing this idea, and we say, okay, God, your will be done, we're really saying, okay, lead me into my purpose. Work it all together for good, for me, and for everybody I love. And then we really just need to, at that point, accept what happens as part of his plan. Either his perfect plan, or something that he will work together for our good. Either way, we're okay. So see, when you embrace this mindset and this element of faith and hope, you know that one way or another, if you're saying to God, your will be done, it's all going to work out. That's not to say that there aren't going to be hard times, tough times. There will. It's for the purpose of you learning what you need to know for the next thing. Because so many things, like empathy, for example, how can you have empathy for something that you haven't experienced, you haven't gone through, you've heard about it, you can have sympathy, but but we really don't know what it feels like, for example, to be the victim of a violent crime, unless we've been the victim of a violent crime. We don't know what it feels like, for example, to live out life in a wheelchair, unless we've been in a wheelchair and had to rely on other people to help us for certain things. So going through hard things may be part of it. And I know that there are a lot of people who don't want to hear that, who want to hear sort of a prosperity message that, you know, if you work hard enough and you believe strongly enough that everything will be perfect, you'll have it all. And, you know, I have to be honest and say, I've been there. And it actually did work for me. That whole thought of, you know, praying and asking God and believing that I would receive. And through my life, I mean, my first book was called From Foster Care to Millionaire. I've literally seen it. I've done the whole, you know, pray and visualize, and I wrote down my goals. I have, oh my gosh, a giant Rubbermaid bin full of journals that I've been writing since I was a teenager. And all the goals that I wrote in all the journals, I have to say, I achieved every one of the things I wanted, except for one. But now I know, having been on the other side of having a beach house in Malibu and having all the fancy cars and going to amazing places for vacation, and, you know, and having a beautiful, really mansion overlooking the ocean and all of these things that I've had, I look back now and I think, okay, but they don't guarantee happiness. They don't guarantee that nothing bad is ever going to happen. They don't keep you from experiencing sickness. They don't keep you from ever dying. I mean, we're all going to leave this life. There's 100% chance of it, right? So we want to make sure that we make the most of the time that we have here and that we have our ticket for eternal life, for the next life through Jesus. Jesus said that he came to give us abundant life, eternal life later and abundant life now. An abundant life, though, does not mean that you have every material thing that you could possibly imagine that you want, because I'm here to tell you, when you're on that material thing train, there's always something more. There's always something better. There's always the newer model of the car. There's always somebody who has the better house, and now you want to run and, you know, chase after the bigger, the better house or whatever it is. I wrote a blog about chasing happiness. That's not how you get it. That's not how you get real peace and joy. That's not how you create healthy relationships and a sense of wellness and contentedness that you can't get any other way. All of that comes with living your purpose. Circling all the way back to the beginning of the whole point of this podcast about how work can be our vehicle for the fulfillment of our purpose. The whole point is the purpose. It's not about the stuff that we can acquire. It's not about the places we can go, the kind of cars we can drive, all of that. I have to say, I've not had money. I've been completely broke. I was homeless when I was a little girl. I know what it is to be completely broke, like no food broke. And only the clothes on your back broke. I know how that feels. And I've experienced financial blessings like I never thought were even possible. And it is easier. It just is easier to live life when you have financial provision. I'm not trying to say that we all need to take up the vow of poverty. No, not at all, because money's a tool with which you can do amazing things. Financial provision gives you the opportunity not only to take care of yourself and the people that you love, but to do good things in the world, because they all cost money. That's the way our world works. But at the end of all of it, if you're doing all of that and you're not embracing your purpose, finding your purpose, living it, evolving in it, then you're missing it. And if you're in a job that you really can't stand, and you're not seeing your perspective of how this time that you're exchanging with this employer is helping you to build your purpose, to develop your character, to teach you the lessons that you need to know for the next step, for the next chapter of your life, you know, then maybe you are in the wrong place. And I would just say, pray about it and then pay attention to what happens next. So I would love to hear what you think. I would love to hear your questions. The bottom line of all of this is that I want everybody to have an amazing life, to laugh without fear of the future, to laugh every day, to enjoy your life, to not be sad and depressed and miserable and going to a job that you can't stand. I have an amazing life now. I can honestly say I love my life now. I want that for you and everyone in your life. So I hope to hear from you. You can go to my website, rhonda.org, and send me a message through there or direct message me on Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn. Twitter. I'm on all those things. I don't know what I'm doing there, but I'm not very good at all that stuff. But I'd love to hear from you. I'd love to hear about your purpose and any questions you have about how to find it and how to live it. Because I know now in this season of my life that my purpose is helping other people find and live theirs. And live the lives that God created you to live and to be able to do what He made you to do. And there is nothing, nothing so good as that. All right, see you next week.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.